This is the second in a series of three on the topic benzene or aromatic chemistry. You will have looked at the benzene lecture first of all. So here we take a look at the CCA past papers. And it has to be said that in regard to Module 5, CEA do favour this particular topic. In relative terms, there are quite a lot of questions on benzene chemistry. So let's make a start and proceed quickly through these questions. Pause and have a go. So it's giving us uses, but it's asking us for a source. The source, of course, is petroleum, otherwise known as crude oil, or fractions C6 to C8. But instead of mentioning something complicated like reforming, just go straightforwardly for petroleum or crude oil. Again, pause and have a go. So do you remember that equation for the reaction between concentrated nitric acid and concentrated sulfuric acid in making up the so-called nitrating mixture? Different forms of this equation. Did you get this one? Any one of these? This is the one I would favour. 2 moles of sulfuric acid, 1 mole of nitric acid, producing the nitronium ion, as well as H3O plus, hydroxonium ion, and the hydrogen sulfate ion there. But you may have your own particular favourite. This one's not so good in my opinion, doesn't show the NO2 plus ion directly. Perhaps you consider this the simplest, most straightforward, 1 mole of each, sulfuric and nitric, forming the nitronium ion, and then you remember hydrogen sulfate and water. But this is the one that I would favour. Pause and have a go. In the preparation of methyl 3 nitrobenzoate. So we've got C double bond O, OCH3. That's methyl benzoate. React that with the NO2 plus the nitronium ion. This part really doesn't get involved in the reaction. 3 gives a clue as to where the NO2 group is going to go on. If this is carbon 1, this will be 2, 3. So it's going to go on there. So the intermediate, just for a little bit of revision, might be shown like so. With the H and the NO2 both attached at this stage. Then this bond here between the C and the H, two electrons go back in to complete the ring. And that forms the product then, with the NO2 group on here. And we've got there methyl 3 nitrobenzoate. What would happen if the temperature wasn't kept under control? Well, the simple answer, to prevent further nitration, so that instead of getting mononitration, you have di or trinitration. Moving on. Here we have phenylamine. Remember the lone pair of electrons on that nitrogen, making it a Lewis base, lone pair donator. Now the name for phenylamine is aniline. It's prepared in the lab by the reduction of nitrobenzene. Write an equation for the reduction of nitrobenzene. Can you remember the reactants and the conditions? And is the acid dilute or concentrated? So first of all, we've got to write an equation for this reaction. And remember how I showed in the lecture we can use square brackets H as a simple way of representing reduction. We have the NO2 group on here. Those two oxygens are going to be converted to water. and each water has two hydrogens, so we need four hydrogens to convert the two O's to two water molecules. And then, in producing the product, the organic product, we will get the NO2 group changing to a so-called amino group. So there are two hydrogens there, and four here, six. So to balance this, we need a six in there, like so. Didn't ask for the conditions there, but it would be hydrochloric acid, concentrated hydrochloric acid, and tin. Aniline is basic and reacts with strong inorganic acids, so an acid alkali giving a base reaction. Compare the basicity, how basic, how strongly basic or how strongly alkaline is aniline compared to that of ammonia. I remember the old name, and I have this in my head, AW, helps me to remember that aniline is weaker, but it's quite easy to reason out that it's weaker and why indeed it's weaker. Remembers to do with the fact that what makes ammonia, NH3, a Lewis base, a weak alkali, is the fact that it's got this non-bonding electron pair that it can donate to accept a proton in reacting with an acid. Phenylamine is a bit like ammonia, where we have replaced one of the H's, perhaps this one, with a phenyl group, C6H5. And methylamine, CH3, is a bit like where we have taken one of the H's off ammonia and replaced it with a CH3. This is a stronger, aliphatic amines are stronger bases, whereas the aromatic amine is a weaker base. Can you recall why? It's to do with the availability of the lone pair on the nitrogen. All three of these molecules have a nitrogen with a lone pair. All of them are alkaline. The lone pair here on the middle one, the phenylamine, the lone pair on the nitrogen, is less available because the benzene ring is described as being electron withdrawing. So by pulling even more electrons from the nitrogen, it makes the lone pair, the nitrogen, less inclined to share the lone pair. It makes it a weaker Lewis base, a weaker alkali. In contrast, methyl groups are electron donating, and in donating electrons along the bond towards this nitrogen, it makes it more prepared to share the non-bonding electron pair, makes the lone pair more available, makes it a stronger Lewis base, it makes it a stronger weak alkali than ammonia. Write an equation for the reaction of excess aniline with sulfuric acid. Have a go at that, see how you get on. Did you get this? So, if this had been ammonia, we'd simply have had 2NH3 plus H2SO4 produces NH4 twice SO4, ammonium sulfate. This is really the equivalent of that in organic terms. You're taking two of these molecules, aniline or phenylamine, and you're getting a salt. This is called ammonium sulfate, and this is because of the phenyl group C6H5. Its name is very similar. So this is ammonium sulfate, and its name ends in ammonium sulfate, but it's known as phenyl ammonium sulfate. And the reasoning we had earlier, if you compare the basicity of ammonia, aniline, and aminobutane, we have here an aliphatic amine is going to be the strongest base. So if we're going increasing in strength, the strongest is the aliphatic, followed by ammonia, followed by the aromatic amine, for reasons I just described. Pause again and have a go. This is the reaction where we're reacting aniline, aminobenzene, with nitrous acid. Remember how nitrous acid has to be made in situ by the reaction of sodium nitrite, NaNO2, and concentrated hydrochloric acid. not specifying the concentration of the acid, but sodium nitrite, better get that bit right, and hydrochloric acid. They together generate HNO2, which results in the formation of this. Do you remember the name of this chemical? It's the diazonium ion. It's known as the benzene diazonium ion. It's got, coming out from the benzene ring, we've got an N with a triple bond to another N, and the positive charge is on that carbon, on that nitrogen, the one attached directly to the benzene ring. And that'll be formed, present as a salt, for example, benzene diazonium chloride. That is unstable above temperature, above a temperature of 5 degrees centigrade. Okay, a solution of diazonium ion is treated with aqueous potassium cyanide. We did look at this to some extent at the end of the lecture on benzene. So very reactive, this chemical. This is the benzene diazonium ion. You can see what's happening here. You just have to warm it or let the temperature rise to room temperature, add KCN, and this comes away to produce nitrogen, N2, as well as this organic product, which has a C triple bond N. A nitrile group can easily be hydrolyzed to produce a carboxylic acid group, so this is benzoic acid over here. A useful step in many synthesis reactions. If you get a nitrile, you can easily reduce a nitrile to an amine. What you're doing is that C triple bond N is changing to a C with two H's on it, as well as an NH2 on it. So you're actually putting in there a total of four H's, and that's a reduction reaction that can be carried out typically by refluxing with lithium aluminium hydride. The amine here is being converted, as you can see, to an alcohol. And this is the most difficult of the reactions A, B, and C. What's happening here is we're converting the NH2 group using the nitrous acid, which is created from sodium nitrite and hydrochloric acid, and we're creating the diazonium ion. And then by simply having aqueous conditions present, that will break up to produce N2 and introduce this OH group onto the carbon. So, did you get these? We use a mineral acid to bring about the hydrolysis of a nitrile to carboxylic acid group. That could also be brought about by, hydrolysis could also be brought about using an alkali, but it would form the sodium salt of this, but then you could simply add a strong mineral acid, and it would convert the sodium salt of this to the acid itself. But in one step, simply by heating with mineral acids, like that means the mineral acids are nitric acid, hydrochloric acid, sulfuric acid. This is reduction, remember, B, so that's lithium aluminium hydride. And we've just discussed this then, HNO2, which is produced in situ by the reaction of sodium nitrite with hydrochloric acid. So a relatively straightforward question, but then if you're out by one hydrogen, you're wrong. So what about carbons? There's one carbon here, one there, one there, one there, one there, and there. So you have a total, if we start here, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 carbons just in that part of the molecule. But then you have carbons here, so you have another 6 carbons there, so you have a total of 16 carbons. You have 2 nitrogens, and remember at each of these corners here where there's nothing written, there is actually a hydrogen on each of those. All of those have a hydrogen on them. What about these? Well, they have their valency there already, so there are no additional hydrogens on these. That's important that you should appreciate that. There are hydrogens on here, so there's 5 more hydrogens at the bottom here. And there's a no and another hydrogen there. If you do all that right, you should come out with an answer, 248. Pause and have a go. I'll give you time to read the question, but we haven't actually looked at this in the lecture, so we'll go straight then to the answer. So azo 2 naphthol contains a chromophore. Identify this chromophore and explain how its structure is affected by the addition or removal of hydrogen ions. Let me say a little bit about what a chromophore is. When a molecule absorbs certain wavelengths of visible light and then transmits or reflects other wavelengths of light within the colour part of the spectrum, such a molecule will appear coloured. So we've come across this before, the absorption of electromagnetic radiation, making electrons make particular jumps, and then as the electrons jump back down again, energy is emitted in the form of electromagnetic radiation, and if the wavelength of that light corresponds to part of the colour part of the spectrum, the molecule appears coloured. Chromophores almost always arise in one of two different forms, and you've come across this commonly in metal complexes where electrons are jumping from one level to another, energy level to another, or from one specific atomic orbital to another. In this particular example, it's the other type, namely where we have a conjugated pi system, in other words in a double bond, and in this particular instance it's in a nitrogen-nitrogen double bond, as you can see here. This particular bond here. Remember, this nitrogen, and this is the key nitrogen in this particular example, has a lone pair of electrons there, a non-bonding electron pair. It also has an electron in this bond, an electron in the upper bond, and an electron in the lower bond. Those five dots represent the five electrons of this nitrogen, five valence shell electrons. When this hydrogen here comes in, it comes in without any electrons, comes in as a hydrogen ion. And what's happening here is, this has been a dative covalent bond, both electrons supplied by these two electrons of the nitrogen. When the nitrogen agrees to share this pair of electrons with the hydrogen ion, it is effectively down an electron, which is why it has a positive charge. The double bond is still there, but it has the fact now that the nitrogen has a positive charge will mean the nitrogen will be drawing on those electrons, and that has an influence on the pi system such that causes a change in the delocalization of the electrons in the N double bond N. And I can only presume then that as a result of that, when this happens, that the molecule then loses its color. The identity of aniline, that's aminobenzene or phenylamine, may be confirmed using ethanoyl chloride. We can use, by the way, AR to represent the benzene ring, so we could simply represent phenylamine, which is also known as aniline, also known as aminobenzene. We could represent it like that. And we're considering here a reaction which is reacting with ethanoyl chloride, which is CH3C double bond OCl. Now, this of course will behave as a nucleophile because of the lone pair of electrons on the nitrogen of the amino group. And we will have here, we're not required to look at the equation for this reaction, but let's look at it just in order to understand what's happening a little bit better. So we have a delta plus charge here, delta minus, and the chlorine's a good leaving group. What will happen is this lone pair of electrons will come into the delta plus to form a bond, and we'll end up getting CH3, C double bond O, and the N will come in here, the H will come off that, and we'll have the aromatic or the benzene ring, which I can show in full rather than AR in this instance, and we get this product plus HCl. The significance as far as this question is concerned is that this is a solid, and we can obtain the melting point of that solid after we have recrystallized it and obtained it in a pure state. Let's look at the name of this chemical here. We can see if this group here was a hydrogen, it would be a simple amide. It would be called ethanamide. But it's not simple because a second hydrogen on the NH2, so to speak, has been replaced with a C6H5. It's known as phenyl ethanamide. And we use a capital N with a dash to signify the fact that the phenyl part of it has replaced a hydrogen not on the alkyl part of the molecule, but one of the H's of the NH2. So the product is a solid. Its name is N-phenylethanamide. The question really is asking us here, the identity of aniline may be confirmed by this reaction. Outline, giving practical details, how this may be carried out, and you've got to look for the quality of written language. 4 marks overall, then 2 marks for the quality of communication. So what would you come up with here? Practical details. You should write down the names of apparatus that you'd need. You'll need for recrystallization typically what? Well, you're going to need your Buchner apparatus and siphon pump or vacuum pump for any recrystallization process. As it says, outline, we'll talk about taking the product, which is a solid, and filtering it using a Buchner apparatus. Remember what the Buchner apparatus looks like, with the Buchner funnel. Looks something like this along the top. We put a little piece of filter paper here. This then enters into quite a thick conical flask with a side arm. We attach this to a siphon pump that looks something like this. And as water rushes down here from the water tap, it sucks air in from here. And as the air gets sucked in here, it sucks air down through here, quickly filtering the liquid through, and also as it's pulling air through the solid on the filter paper, it helps to dry it by air drying, is called, I think. Now, once you would have recrystallized it using a suitable solvent, so you'd have to find, I don't think you need to identify a particular solvent that would be useful. If I had to pick one, I would probably go for ethanol, which is a solvent that will tend to dissolve both organic and inorganic chemicals. You would have to mention, remember, using the minimum volume of the suitable solvent, minimum volume of hot solvent. You might filter it while it's hot in order to remove impurities that are insoluble in the hot solvent. You'd let it cool to room temperature slowly, cool it further in an ice bath, and then filter it once again. And of course then you could determine, you would dry it between filter papers and then find its melting point. And if you go to tables that show the melting points of the products of different amines with this particular S-al chloride, ethanoal chloride, you can work backwards and determine which particular amine you must have used, in this case, phenylamine. Let's look at the mark scheme. So you would have to add your ethanoal chloride to get the reaction to take place. That would produce a solid, which is your phenyl N-phenylethanamide. You'd filter that solid off using a Buchner funnel. You would purify it by recrystallization for a mark. You'd use the minimum amount of hot solvent, perhaps ethanol. One of the things that you should do when you have filtered it completely in that initial stage, this is before you use the ethanol to recrystallize it, you should wash the crystals with cold deionized water. Drying is part of it. Determining the melting point, comparing with the value against values in a data book, and then reasoning which particular amine must have reacted with your acyl chloride. Moving on. So they exhibit cis-trans isomerism. Suggest why cis-trans is possible with diazonitriles. Well, this aspect comes up when we're looking at the valence shell electron pair repulsion theory. It's not the bonds, but the pairs of electrons that are important in the valence shell. And this pair of electrons here takes up a space, as does this. So although there's no group attached to that, when we're looking at that molecule, we've got two nitrogens with a double bond between them. We have a lone pair of electrons that takes up a specific space. And there's one possible arrangement that we could have. C6, I like to do it, showing the nitrogen is attached to the carbon and then goes to the hydrogen, so it's better that it's written like that. But this would be a different molecule if we had the nitrogens connected like so, and the CN going up, this lone pair coming down, this one staying where it was, and the C6H5 here. Writing that, of course, sorry. It'd be C6 there, C6 there, and H5 here, like so. This would be the trans, and this would be the cis. Again, I explained it's important that we appreciate that the shape is dictated not by the groups that are attached, but by the pairs of electrons around the nitrogens. Let's get rid of those scribbles. So if you've had a go, let's take a look at the answers then. So it's the restricted, they're looking for a restricted rotation about the N double bond N, that's important. I didn't mention that. I was focusing on the pairs of electrons, but what I said was important, and it's being, although they're leaving out the pairs of electrons here, that's the explanation for why these particular shapes are fixed shapes. But again, I except that I would have lost the mark here for not having mentioned the restricted rotation about the N double bond end. Cis, where they're both on the same side, anti or trans, where they're opposite. The empirical formula is the lowest whole number ratio. So while the molecular formula is C6H6, that's not the empirical formula. State and explain the shape of the benzene molecule. Remember how we said that it's a flat hexagonal ring where all six carbons and indeed all six hydrogens coming out here, they're all in the same flat plane with a gravy ring shaped cloud of electrons both above and below these delocalized electrons. Now I've stated the shape, I need to explain the shape. And again, remember how when it comes to the carbon that the 2s, one of the 2s electrons is promoted up to the 2p, so we, instead of having 2s2, 2p2, we end up with 2s1, 3p3, and remember how the 2s electron and the 3px and the 3py, how they merge or hybridize to form three identical sp2 orbitals that are 120 degrees, doesn't look like it here, but 120 degrees between these, and then we have the remaining 3pz orbital which doesn't hybridize and it sits both above the plane and below, and then how these 3pz orbitals overlap. So did you get this? C6H6 can be reduced down to CH, that's the empirical formula. Flat hexagonal ring we mentioned. And it's caused by in simple terms, the overlapping of P orbitals. So it's not necessary to remember this sort of detail I've shown here. It's better though that you would understand that. But the shape is down to the overlapping of those P orbitals, the 2PZ orbitals above and below. Why? Because it gives maximum delocalization, and delocalization makes the molecule more stable. It lowers its enthalpy, and that's why the molecule chooses to do that when it has the opportunity. You only get this mark for delocalization if you have also mentioned the overlapping of the P orbitals. Remember that, the key three key points: flat hexagonal ring, P orbitals overlapping. Those are the 3PZ orbitals overlapping right around the ring, both above and below. And this gives the molecule maximum delocalization, maximum stability, lowest enthalpy. Pause and have a go. Suggest why, despite delocalization, benzene is not coloured. We saw that colour, a short time ago there, when we were looking at chromophores, that colour comes up either as a feature of transition metals, or where we have pi bonds, delocalized electron systems. Now, the benzene molecule does indeed have delocalized electrons, so why isn't it colored? And can you name an industrial source of benzene? Did you get this? It does have delocalized electrons, and the answer they're looking for is that the delocalization is not sufficiently extended, or something in terms of energy level explanation, that the difference in the energies of the electrons does not correspond to the wavelength of visible light. But you can just keep it simple and say that while delocalized, it's not extended enough. And of course, petroleum or crude oil as a source. Pause and have a go. Phenyl ethylamine. If we were ignoring that group there and it was just a H, it would be ethylamine. But we've replaced the H. Now, we must, because this is an amine, we must number the carbon that holds the functional group 1, and this is 2. So we have if this was just a H, it would be, that I have rubbed out here, then it would be ethylamine. Because I've replaced one of the H's with a C6H5, it's phenylamine. So, it is a chemical cousin of an amphetamine drug, which you see here. All that has happened is one of these two hydrogens has been replaced by a CH3 group. So very, very similar indeed. It has a high boiling point liquid, which is found to a large extent in chocolate and to a lesser extent in the brain. The effect of eating chocolate and taking amphetamines in terms of brain chemistry are therefore similar. Explain which of these molecules is chiral. It eventually got to the point. To be chiral, we must have a carbon that has got four different groups attached. And there's nothing in this molecule that fits that description, but this particular carbon here, we draw it out, it's got a CH3 attached to it, it's got that H attached to it, I'll put that in the middle there, it's got that NH2 attached to it, and it's also got this big group here attached to it, which is the CH2 and the benzene ring then as well. So that does indeed have four groups. The answer is the amphetamine. Explain why these molecules are chiral. So in fact the other one must be chiral as well. Sorry, it says which of these. Sorry, yeah, so that's was correct in the first place. This is not chiral, this one is chiral, and the reason is it has a carbon with four different groups attached. Okay. So we have to look at whether the amines on the previous slide are primary amines or not. Let's have a look back at them again. Remember, the principle of primary amine is that only one of the hydrogens on the ammonia molecule has been replaced by an alkyl group. So we must still have NH2. If we've got RN, this kind of arrangement, that's a secondary amine. And if we have R, if we've replaced all three of the hydrogens and ammonia with R groups, the significance of the dash and double dash is just to indicate that the R groups don't have to be the same, but they could be. Then this would be a tertiary amine, this is a secondary amine, and this is a primary amine. If we go back, I think you can see that these molecules, as you can see over the under the script or under the writing there, you can see that they both have the NH2, so they are both primary amines. The boiling point of phenyl ethylamine is 195 degrees centigrade, whereas the boiling point of propyl benzene is less, at 159. So let's compare these two molecules. Let's look at what we're comparing here. We have a benzene ring in both cases. In the case of phenylethylamine, we've got CH2, CH2, NH2. In the case of the other molecule in question, propyl benzene, well then we've got CH2, CH2. And instead of an NH2 group, we have a CH3 group. And we see that this here has a lower boiling point, which means it has got weaker intermolecular forces. So we have to explain that. And the clear answer here is the NH2 group. If you have a hydrogen attached to an N, attached to an O, or attached to an F, in these instances you can have hydrogen bonding. And hydrogen bonds are particularly strong intermolecular forces. So the answer would be point for saying that this molecule alone can hydrogen bond. Another mark for saying that hydrogen bonds are strong or stronger forces, and that's likely where the marks come up. Let's have a look at the mark scheme answer. Yes, they're both primary amines, they've both got the NH2 group. Hydrogen bonding present in the phenylethylamine between the amino groups, in other words the NH2 groups. As a result, you have stronger intermolecular forces. Moving on, more practical chemistry. The amphetamine is a liquid, slightly soluble in water, with a boiling point 200-202 degrees C. When administered in the form of a drug, it's used as an amphetamine sulfate, which is a solid. Amphetamine sulfate, well, remember, if it's got an amine group, if you had NH3, for example, and you reacted that with sulfuric acid H2SO4, ratio 2 moles to 1, you would end up with ammonium sulfate. And the equivalent is happening here with this molecule. Instead, we've got that benzene ring part, CH2. Let me just remind myself what it looked like. It was CH2, then we had a CH3, NH2. And two of those will react with H2SO4 in rather the same way as I've shown in the simpler case with ammonia. And that's how they would produce the sulfate salt of the amphetamine. So you have to write is formed by the reaction of the amphetamine with sulfuric acid. So hopefully you could take this instead of the ammonia and react it to form the equivalent of this, which clearly is going to be that C6H5 bit with the CH2 and then the CH with the CH3, and the NH2 will have become NH3 with a positive charge on the nitrogen, and then you'll have the sulfate SO4. And because this ion has a single positive charge, you'll need two of those to balance the two minus of the sulfate. Explain why amphetamine sulfate is a solid, whereas the amphetamine is a liquid. Well, because you've created ions here, clearly, and the forces between ions are stronger than hydrogen bonds that you would have in the amphetamine itself. Let's look at the Mark scheme answer. You see there effectively what I showed a moment ago. And yes, we've created ionic bonds which are stronger than the hydrogen bonds that would be present between the amino groups in the amphetamine itself. Explain how amphetamine can be reformed from amphetamine sulfate. So if you've got a salt, think of ammonium sulfate, and obtain once again as a liquid in a state of high purity. Well, there's a bit of a difference between this and the actual salt. This is an inorganic salt, whereas we were looking there a moment ago on the previous slide. This is what we would call an organic salt, and I'll just say OS for organic salt. Organic salts are not as stable as inorganic salts. So if I offer this salt the opportunity to change into an inorganic salt by adding to it a strong acid like, for example, by adding a strong alkali like, for example, sodium hydroxide, that will take place naturally at room temperature. Again, so if I add a strong alkali, what's it going to do? The sodium will take the sulfate to form an inorganic salt, sodium sulfate, and then we'll regenerate the amine. We'll get water, plus the hydrogen will come off. If you imagine one of these H's coming off to combine with the OH minus, so you'd have OH minus plus the H plus coming off to give us back our NH2. That would give water. So you're basically taking, if I can write OS for the organic salt, plus sodium hydroxide. We're going to change from a less stable organic salt to a much more stable inorganic salt, which would be, in this case, the sulfate, sodium sulfate, Na2SO4. But we're also going to get the hydrogen will come off the NH3 part to combine with the hydroxide ion to give water, and that will regenerate the amine or the amphetamine again.